give thanks to the Holy One. Give thanks because He's given Jesus Christ, His Son. Give thanks with a grateful heart. Give thanks to the Holy One. Give thanks because He's given Jesus Christ.
Good morning. Let us pray. I will sing and make melody with all my being. I will give thanks to you, O Lord, among the peoples. I will sing praises to you among the nations. For your steadfast love is great above the heavens. Your faithfulness reaches to the clouds. Dearly heavenly loving Father, thank you for this wonderful morning time, O Lord. Thank you for giving us the opportunity to worship you. We give all heartfelt thanks to you, O God, that you have provided life to us. You gave your life for us, O God, so that we may have life. We are enjoying that, O God. We are very much grateful indeed for that. O God, accept our worship and thanksgiving. Help us to feel your presence always. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Amen. Shall we all sing from the church hymnal, hymn number 12, Praise to the Holiest in the Height and in the Depth Be Praise.
Let us worship God. God is spirit, and those who worship Him must worship in spirit and truth. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. The Lord is near to all who call on Him, to all who call on Him in truth. Enter His gates with thanksgiving and His courts with praise. Give thanks to Him. Bless His name. Ascribe to the Lord the glory due His name. Bring an offering and come into His courts. Worship the Lord in holy splendor. Tremble before Him, all the earth. Let the heavens be glad, and let the earth rejoice. Let the sea roar, and all that fills it. Let the field exult, and everything in it. Then shall all the trees of the forest sing for joy. O Lord, open our lips, and our mouth shall sing forth your praise. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Praise be to you, O God the Father, who created all things by your power and wisdom, and loved the world so as to give your Son to be your Savior. Praise be to you, O God the Son, who was made human like us in all things except sin, and was delivered for our offenses and raised again for our justification. Praise be to you, O God the Holy Spirit, who does lead us into all truth and does shed abroad the love of God in our hearts. All praise and glory be to you, O God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, forever and ever. Amen. If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, He who is faithful and just will forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. The time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe in the good news. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but we have one who in every respect has been tested as we are, yet without sin. Let us kneel and examine ourselves in silence. Let us humbly confess our sins to the Almighty God. Almighty and most merciful God, we have erred and strayed from your ways like lost sheep. We have followed too much the devices and desires of our own hearts. We have offended against your holy laws. We have left undone those things which we should have done, and we have done those things which we should not have done. And there is no health in us. But you, O Lord, have mercy upon us. Miserable offenders, spare them, O God, who confess their faults. Restore them that are penitent according to your promises, declared to humankind in Christ Jesus our Lord. And grant, O most merciful God, for his sake, that we may hereafter live a godly, righteous, and just life to the glory of your holy name. Amen.
May the Almighty and merciful Lord grant us pardon and remission for all our sins, time for amendment of life, and the grace and comfort of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Let us thank God. After every prayer, I request you to say, "We praise your name, O Lord. We praise your name, O Lord." For the church and for the good news of Jesus Christ, which she proclaims, we praise your name, O Lord. For the light of this good news declared unto every nation, tongue, and people, we praise your name, O Lord. You have redeemed us and called us with a high calling in Jesus Christ. You have given us the fellowship of your Spirit and enabled us to be as your church in this land. We praise your name, O Lord. In darkness you have been our light. In adversity and temptation, a rock of strength. In our joys, the very crown of joy, in our labors all sufficient reward, for all your long suffering and the abundance of your grace, we praise your name, O Lord. For the Church of South India, which you have called to be a movement towards unity of the churches and unity of all humankind, we praise your name, O Lord. For the opportunities you have provided to each one of our church members to be partners in your mission, we praise your name, O Lord. For the gift of the good news which challenges and transforms our social, economic, political, and cultural structures and institutions, we praise your name, O Lord. Eternal God, creator of the world and giver of all good, we thank you for the earth, our home, and for the gift of life. We thank you for all your mercies, for your goodness that has created us, your grace that sustains us, your discipline that seeks to correct us, your patience that has borne with us, and your love that redeems us. Help us to love you and to be thankful for all your gifts, serve you and delight in doing your will, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Shall we all sing this song, "Give Thanks with a Grateful Heart," in preparation for the pastoral prayer?
His son.
Almighty God, our loving Heavenly Father, we thank you and praise you for all your goodness, your mercy, and your blessings that you have bestowed upon us. We come to you seeking thy grace. We ask you to protect us from all possible danger and continue to guard us, O God. At this time, we remember the victims of blast in Beirut in Lebanon. 100 people were killed, many were injured. And the people of Mumbai, they are experiencing heavy rain, and many people have lost their houses. Even the entire city is flooded. The children suffer without food. We pray for your continuous guidance and your protection for the people that suffering with the heavy rain and flood in Mumbai. And also, Lord, we come to you with a heavy heart for the victims of Indian Airlines crash at Kozhikode in Kerala, where the aeroplane slipped off the runway and 18 people were killed. Even the pilot himself was killed. We pray to you to console the victims and all those who are injured and undergoing treatment at the hospitals. And also we pray for the natural disaster due to the heavy rain, a big landslide reported in Kerala, Munnar, and nearly 40 plantation workers were buried. Heavenly Father, when we look all these things, the natural disaster and bomb blast and heavy rain and flood, we come to you for your protection and your mercy is to be extended to all those who suffer, and be gracious unto them, O God. We pray for our country. We pray for the leaders of our country. The country is in total lockdown for the last 135 days. And during this lockdown, so many things are happening. Heavenly Father, we know that you are in control of our country. Making use of this lockdown, there are so many things are happening which is a very serious threat to the constitution of our country. And we commit our national leaders into your mighty hand, O God. Millions are suffering without food, and people suffer without livelihood. This is the condition of our country. Lord, we pray that you continue to guide our leaders to be very sincere, to lead the country. And also we pray for the church in India, which is facing a lot of threats. Heavenly Father, the church in India came some 2,000 years back, but we have not grown in numerical strength. We pray that the church in India should be revived by your spirit. This is the time for revival. The church should pray for a country. The church should help the nation. The church should produce leaders with Christian values. Heavenly Father, we pray that send your Holy Spirit upon the church, O God, so that the churches in India may rise up to the occasion and to bear witness for your ruling in the entire world, O God. We pray for the Church of South India, for the 24 dioceses, and our own diocese of Trichy Thanjavur. And we pray for our bishop, we pray for our pastors, women workers, missionaries, and all those who are involved in caring for the children. We pray for the doctors and the nurses working in the mission hospital. And we pray for the entire mission of the church. We pray that you continue to guide us, O God. Grant us your grace so that we will really take up the real power of the gospel by rendering our service to the needy and poor of our country. We pray for the St. John's Church congregation, a very renowned church, prestigious church, very traditional church in the city of Trichyapalli. We pray that you continue to inspire every family, O God. And we pray for your blessings and your protection to be extended to all the families. We pray for the elderly people in the family, because in the pandemic time, it is very difficult for the old people to survive. We seek your grace, we seek your protection, O God. We pray for the children going to the school and colleges when we do not know when the colleges and schools will reopen. But we pray for your grace. Whenever the college or the school reopens, the children should be prepared to go and learn. Heavenly Father, during the pandemic, we seek your protection for our own children. Keep them under your guidance, O God. We pray for the sick and the needy. And especially, Lord, we pray for every one of us. And once in a week, we come to your church and we praise you, we worship you, and we receive your consolation, your guidance, and your power. But last 4 months, that did not happen. We are confined to our house. But we pray unto you, God. We worship from our own respective places. And we pray that we want to worship you as community. We want the churches to be opened. And with a great disappointment, for the last 4 months, we did not even take part in the Holy Communion, where we are reminded of your sacrifice of your Son on the cross. And we do believe that there is a therapeutic value in the Holy Communion, the Lord's Supper, which we did not experience for the last 4 months. Heavenly Father, we pray that you bring normalcy to our country. Let things become normal. Let people are protected from the corona infection. And let the churches open so that we can come together and praise your holy name for all your goodness, O God. We pray for the pastors of St. John's, your servants, even during the pandemic, their efforts to reach people, their efforts to continue to minister the congregation, the believers, we commit them, we commit their families into the mighty hand, all the workers working in this church workers, and the small village congregation attached with this church, we remember all of them in O God. We pray that you continue to extend your grace and mercy to all the church workers and the pastors of this congregation. Let them not be disappointed or discouraged during this pandemic, but give them your grace and the power of the Holy Spirit to lead the congregation into the deeper experience of faith. We give you thanks for all your goodness, O God. We give all honor and glory to your holy name. We pray and ask all this in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen.
Now the scripture lessons will be read to us.
The Old Testament reading is taken from Deuteronomy chapter 26 verses 1 to 11. Deuteronomy 26, 1 to 11. And it shall be when you come into the land which the Lord your God is giving you as inheritance and you possess it and dwell in it, that you shall take some of the first of the produce of the ground, which you shall bring from your land that the Lord your God is giving you, and put it in a basket and go to the place where the Lord your God chooses to make his name abide. And you shall go to the one who is priest in those days and say to him, I declare today to the Lord your God that I have come to the country which the Lord swore to our fathers to give us. Then the priest shall take basket out of your hand and sit down before the altar of the Lord your God. And you shall answer and say before the Lord your God, my father was Syrian about to perish, and he went down to Egypt and dwelt there, few in number. There he became a nation, great, mighty, and populous. But the Egyptian mistreated, afflicted us, and laid hard bondage on us. Then we cried to the Lord, God our Father, and the Lord heard our voice and looked on affliction and our labor and our oppression. So the Lord brought us out of Egypt with the mighty hand and an outstretched arm, to great terror with the sign of wonders. He has brought us to the place, and he has given to the land of flowing with milk and honey. And now behold, I have brought you the first fruits of the land, which O Lord has given to me. Then you shall set it before the Lord your God, and worship him before the Lord your God. So you shall rejoice in every good thing which the Lord your God has given to you and your house, and You and the Levite and the stranger is among you. Here ends the reading. Praise be to God.
Today's epistle reading is taken from 2 Corinthians chapter 8 verses 1 to 7. 2 Corinthians chapter 8 verses 1 to 7. Beginning from verses 1. Moreover, brethren, we make known to you the grace of God bestowed on the churches of Macedonia, that in a great trial of affliction, the abundance of their joy and their deep poverty abounded in the riches of their liberality. For I bear witness that according to their ability, yes, and beyond their ability, they were freely willing, imploring us with much urgency that we would receive the gift and the fellowship of the ministering to the saints. And not only as we had hoped, but they first gave themselves to the Lord and then to us by the will of God. So we urged Titus that he had begun, so he would also complete this grace in you as well. But as you abound in everything, in faith, in speech, in knowledge, in all diligence, and in your love for us, see that you abound in this grace also. Here ends the reading. Praise be unto God.
The gospel reading is taken from Gospel according to St. Luke, chapter 17, verses 11 to 19. St. Luke, chapter 17, verses from 11 to 19. On the way to Jerusalem, he was passing along between Samaria and Galilee. And as he entered a village, he was met by 10 lepers who stood at a distance and lifted up their voices, saying, "Jesus, Master, have mercy on us." When he saw them, he said to them, "Go and show yourselves to the priests." And as they went, they were cleansed. Then one of them, when he saw that he was healed, turned back, praising God with a loud voice. And he fell on his face at Jesus' feet, giving him thanks. Now he was a Samaritan. Then Jesus answered, "Were not 10 cleansed? Where are the 9? Was no one found to return and give praise to God except this foreigner?" And he said to him, "Rise and go your way. Your faith has made you well." Here ends the reading. Praise be to you, O Lord.
Greetings to you in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. God has provided us one more day and one more week in our life to enjoy, to worship Him and thank Him. Today we are immensely happy to welcome our Bishop in our midst. With his busy schedule, even in the COVID-19 situation, traveling back and forth, in encouraging the institution heads and the teachers all over the diocese, we very much appreciate his leadership and giving guidance in COVID-19 situation to follow the protocol which the government is expecting us to fulfill in the education institutions and get ready to start the schools once again and the admission process. He is doing everything very nicely and giving a good leadership. We are really thankful to him and God for giving us such a wonderful bishop to us. Moreover, we need to pray for his family and their needs and for their ministry. Our prayers will be of great strength and encouraging one for him. Now he is with us to share the word of God. We are going to celebrate the Thanksgiving festival with the diocese. All over the diocese, all the churches are celebrating today as a thanksgiving to God in the COVID-19 situation. We do join with them. So, Bishop, in our midst, I welcome him on behalf of you. Now, we'll sing from the church hymnal 142. "Oh, for 1,000 tongues to sing my dear Redeemer's praise." After this song, we'll listen from our bishop.
peace and grace be unto you. In the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Dear friends, good morning. I give thanks to God for giving another opportunity to participate in this worship. As you all know, it's almost 135 days since the lockdown is declared. And every time we are expecting that the government would allow the churches to be opened for worship. However, it remains the same till 31st of August. And we come to God this morning with a heart full of gratitude for all His blessings, His protection, His mercy that has been extended to all of us. It was a very shocking news that we heard and we see in the newspaper that there was a aeroplane crash in Kozhikode in Kerala state. And actually the Boeing was about to land and there was a problem because of the heavy rain. The pilot could not find the runway, so he slipped off the runway and it was a very big accident, and even the pilot himself was killed and 18 people were killed. That's what the newspaper and the media conveys. And if you look at the other side in Kerala, in the same state, again a natural disaster. For the last 1 week there was continuous downpouring of rain because of the monsoon. So near Munnar there was a landslide and nearly 40 people were buried. This is something, you know, we have to really feel sorry for all the things that are happening around us. But we give thanks to God for His wonderful mercy, and also we remember the victims of this natural disaster in Kerala, and we continue to pray that the Lord would continue to keep His children under His wings. Dear friends, this is a season that we have a Thanksgiving festival in almost all the churches in our diocese, starting from August and maybe mid-September. We'll have Thanksgiving festival in different places in different dates. So I thought I would bring a small devotion about Thanksgiving festival. So perhaps you may think that what is there when everything is locked, when we are confined to our place, we are not able to move out, and what is there to give thanks? So I thought this is the time for us to give thanks to God. Even everything is in adverse circumstances, and we have a lot of things to give thanks to God because He is good and we have to celebrate His goodness. And every year we celebrate Thanksgiving festival. And for our meditation, I would like to bring your attention to a brief study on three scripture passages that was read to us. Rudyard Kipling is a very famous English poet, and he was born and brought up. Of course, he is an European Englishman, and he was born and brought up in Mumbai. His parents were there working in Mumbai when the Britishers were ruling our country. And Rudyard Kipling has become a very great poet. And one of his poems, the title is If, that you can find in the 10th standard syllabus of our state, Samachir Kalvi. Both the teachers and the children find this poem very interesting, very interesting. And Rudyard Kipling, he has become a very popular man now, and he is getting a lot of money, honorarium, because people give money for his publications, for his contribution, for his poems, so on and so forth. And usually it does not happen. You know what happens when somebody is at the peak of their career, poet and all, nobody will care for them. They will not be recognized during their lifetime. Sometimes they die without food, even without money. Only after that people will say, he was a great man, he was a very big poet. They used to praise him like anything. But it is very different with Rudyard Kipling, because in his lifetime, he was recognized very much. Dear friends, once the press reporters asked him, "Sir, you are getting a lot of money as a honorarium for your contribution, for your writing. But when we calculated it, I think it will come per word, you are getting $100. So Rudyard Kipling was so surprised, and he was telling them, I never calculated it, but that you people are doing it. So I'm very happy that you recognized my work, and the royalty that I get, you calculate it. So I'm very happy. All of a sudden, one of the reporters, he gave $100 note to Rudyard Kipling and asked him to say one word, because each word carries $100. So he received that $100 note and he said, thank you. So the press, everybody was laughing, because the word thank you is valued for $100. Dear friends, for Rudyard Kipling, it may be for $100. The word thank you may carry a value of $100. But if you ask Jesus Christ, he will tell you the word thanks or thank you carries $1 million value. Dear friends, we are living in a time where the sense of gratitude is declining. Often we hear people is telling, he is very ungrateful, she is ungrateful. Everywhere you see, people are not really grateful to what they have been receiving from people. Dear friends, this is an occasion for us to give thanks to God. And we are very enthusiastic in asking God to bless us. We are asking God to give us some gifts, and we are very enthusiastic. But the moment we receive it, we are very slow to act. We are very slow to thank God, to express our gratitude. We are not very as enthusiastic as we were asking for the gifts. Dear friends, maybe you may say God is unmoved, nobody can move God. But I tell you, God is not a tree or a rock, but he is a person, he interacts with us. So only when we express our gratitude, God is glorified. So this is a season of thanksgiving. The first reading that was read to us is from book of Deuteronomy, chapter 26, verses 1 to 11. It's a very interesting passage. And here, the people of Israel, the Israelites, were expressing their gratitude by bringing their first fruits to God and to offer in the temple. See, if you look at the history of Israel, the Israelites, actually they were shepherds. They were after the flock. But the time came when they were taken as slaves to Egypt. And they were there in the Egypt for a long time, 400 years. And they were supposed to work in the construction. They were asked to make bricks. They never knew the skills. However, they were forced to work. But God heard their oppression. God chose Moses to be the deliverer, liberator. We all know the story. So now the commandment is given. A clear guidance is given to the people of Israel. 40 years you are able to survive in the wilderness. Now God, Yahweh, the great God of Israel, is taking you to the promised land where milk and honey is flowing. Such a wonderful, fertile land God has promised. When you go there, when you settle there, when you start again your work as shepherds after the flock, when you start cultivating, when you start your agriculture work, remember, it is a gift of God. God has blessed you. So when you get the harvest, you bring the first portion to the altar and you have to give thanks to God. Dear friends, this is something very interesting. It is usually the harvest festival is celebrated during the Hebrew month Ahib. That is during the month of March and April. They bring the first fruits, all the wheat and barley, everything to the altar, and they have to offer to God. And after some time, they have the ingathering festival. See, the festivals are very important in the life of the Israelites. It has a lot of link with their spirituality and social life. So actually, the Greek word used for festival is hag. H-A-G, that is a word used for festival in the Old Testament. So the hug, the festival is nothing but coming together and celebrating as family. or celebrating as community the goodness of God. So God is giving them a commandment that when you go to the promised land, don't forget to give thanks to God for all His gifts. Dear friends, the good harvest is by the grace of God. It is by the gift that God has given to them, the land. The fertile land is a gift to the people of Israel. They were there in the Egypt as slaves. They never even dreamed of such a great blessing. They never even expected that God would bless them abundantly to have cultivation, to have harvest in plenty, bountiful. This is how the people of Israel were abundantly blessed. So now the commandment is to go and give thanks to God for the gifts that you received. Here just I want to make only one observation. Dear friends, we all have to go and give thanks to God for all the gifts that God has bestowed upon us, all the blessing that we have received. But we have to be very cautious, because many times what happens, we celebrate the gifts, but not the one who has given the gifts. Again, I'm telling you, we celebrate the gifts. We think of the wealth that we are enjoying. They think of all the status or all the privileges that we are enjoying. We are very happy, we are celebrating, but we never acknowledge that it was by the grace of God. So the Israelites were given prompt guidance that this is because of God, the great God who has delivered from them Egypt. Dear friends, this Thanksgiving festival is a festival where we acknowledge God as the giver of gifts. Let us not think that the gift has come from somewhere above, but it is a blessing, gift that God has given to us. So many times it happens with us that we don't really celebrate God and His goodness, but we always celebrate the gifts that we have. So this is what the commandment given to the Israelites. So in the Thanksgiving festival, let us think the blessings that we have been bestowed upon us, and the God who is the source of our all blessings, all our gifts. So let us give thanks to God. The second lesson that was read to us is a very beautiful lesson that you come across Paul's letter to the Corinthians, chapter 8. He talks about the Christian giving. Of course, there is a connection between thanksgiving and the giving offertory. He put it in other words, thanksgiving has a very strong implication with Christian giving. Because if you read the Bible, the love cannot be expressed by words. Your love towards somebody cannot be expressed only with mere words. So if you read John chapter 3 verse 16, God so loved the world and He gave His only Son. Only by giving, only by concrete action, you can express your love towards somebody. So God loved the humankind and He gave His only begotten Son. Our love can be expressed only by giving. That is a very basic logic of Christian giving. We give because we love God. We love God because we belong to the covenant. God has made a covenant with us to be our God, and we as His children. So Christian giving has a lot of implications with the thanksgiving. In the Macedonian church, Paul is exhorting them, because the generosity that the people shown in the churches at Macedonia was something very great. So if you look at the text, you will come across the kind of Christian giving expressed by the Macedonian believers. They were already in distress. They were in need. They were in utter poverty. They were in affliction. In all these circumstances, they did not forget to give to God. So Christian giving is something in which we express our love to God. Our thanksgiving can be expressed only in Christian giving. Dear friends, there are four types of giving expressed in the Jewish literature. And number one, a group of people, they give, they don't motivate others to give. Only they give, they don't motivate others to give. There is another group of people, they don't give, they will motivate others to give. There is a third group of people, they don't give, they don't encourage others also to give. But there are saints who give and also who encourage others to give. This is the kind of giving expressed in Jewish literature. But in giving, you cannot beat God. In other words, God is the highest giver. He has given his own son to be the savior of the world. Dear friends, look at these Macedonian believers. They were so generous in giving. How did they give? They give according to their ability. Sometimes beyond their ability, they give wholeheartedly. And how did they give? They gave themselves to God first, then afterwards they gave to the ministry of the church. Dear friends, this is one important thing that we have to understand. See, when we talk about Christian givings from the pulpit, sometimes people may not like it. Sometimes the preachers also feel a bit delicate, because the Christian giving is not very much understood by either by the preachers or by the congregation. But you look at these Macedonian churches, Macedonian believers, they are willing to give because they love God. They dedicated themselves to God. During the 1930s, there was a great famine in Karur area. Karur is a very important place in our diocese. In the Karur area, there was a great pandemic, like big cholera. Cholera was there. And everywhere, people were dying. And actually, there were few missionaries staying at Karur. And they were so sad to hear, to see people were dying around them, particularly in the remote villages, where few believers were there. So the missionaries wanted to go and see what was happening there. But however, a village believer said, "Missionary Dore, please don't come here, because we are native, but we are suffering like anything. But being a foreigner, we do not know how you will withstand all these circumstances." They said not to come. That is what actually exactly happening now. In the COVID-19 situation, if you want to see somebody, if you want to visit somebody, they will say not to come. Padri, not to come. Pastor, not to come, because once you come there, you may be infected. So this is the kind of tense situation in those days. And when the normalcy started returning, the missionaries started visiting people. And they were so sad to see in many villages, the women were left as widows. The men died, huge numbers. And in some of the villages, even the children were found as orphans. In some villages, the women were alive. In some villages, only the men were alive. So the missionaries, the Wesleyan Methodist missionaries, visited one of the remote village in Karur area. The name of the village is Tukachi. It's a very remote village. The missionaries went there, and they were literally in tears to see the people were very much afflicted. And some houses were empty because all of them died. So missionaries went and called a few people in that village, and they sang some songs and they offered some prayers. They prayed for the families, they prayed for the believers. After the prayer, the missionaries told the villagers that we are going now, definitely we will come back, next week we will come. And again, we want to pray for you. We will come next week. Then all of a sudden, one old woman who was standing there said, "Dore, please wait here. I will come. Please wait here." So the missionaries, they did not understand anything. They were waiting. And this old lady came with a small bag. You know, they used to have it here the Surukupai, that is what's called in those days in the villages. She was trying to take few coins and she was about to give to the missionaries. The missionaries said, this is not the time for us to collect offertory. You experienced a great loss. Both you lost everything. So this is not the time to give offertory. So you don't worry. You don't worry, Amma. We will come back next week and we will pray for you. The old women told the missionaries, Dore, whatever may be our circumstances, I know we are in a great grief and loss. And whatever may be the circumstances, we don't want to withhold anything which belongs to God. I have this money with me. You say that you will come next week. When you come next week, if I am not here, then I will leave this world without peace, without fulfilling my commitment. So this is an offertory that I have kept for you. For the glory of God, please accept it, offertory. So the missionaries were so moved. They came back and they wrote a report to their headquarters in London, Methodist Missionary Society, MMS. The missionaries from Karur, what they saw in Tukachi, they wrote a letter to their headquarters in London saying, the faith of the Macedonian churches, the generosity of the Macedonian churches still alive among our believers. Don't think it is a story of the church in the past, maybe during the first century. Even in the 20th century, you can see very well the spirit, the sacrifice, the giving, the generosity of the people who have put their trust in the name of Jesus. Dear friends, this is a time that we have to give to God, realizing in whatever may be the circumstances we are kept, we continue to give God because we give ourselves to God. That is the secret of the Macedonian believers. That is what exactly happened in a small remote village in Karur, Tukachi. People gave themselves to God. Without giving to God, whatever you give to the church, it may not be a great blessing to you. Dear friends, as we have just seen in the first text, that we have to celebrate the giver of the gifts. Of course, we have to celebrate the gift, but more than the gift, the giver of the gift, God, and His goodness to be celebrated. Number two, the Christian giving generosity is a result of dedication to God, like the Macedonian church believers. Now, we come to the very interesting passage that you see in the Gospel according to Luke chapter 17. It's a very interesting passage, and almost you must have heard so many sermons, very interesting sermons on this topic, and it's a very familiar text. However, I would like to highlight one or two important things. How God honors a grateful heart. How Jesus honors a grateful heart. As you all know, Jesus was going through the region between Samaria and Galilee. And He found 10 lepers. He confronted them. And all of them were crying for healing. And you all know the story. And Jesus told them to go and show yourself to the priest in the temple. This is because according to the law. So as they went, only one person returned to Jesus. And he fell at the feet of Jesus. And he was giving thanks because he was healed. So Jesus is not so happy or satisfied with one person coming back and saying thank you. He was asking about the rest of the people. 9 people. Are you not 10 cleansed? Where are they? Where are the other 9 people? This is a question raised by Jesus. See, if you look at this passage, it's very interesting. The evangelist Luke is not very much interested in focusing the miracle that Jesus wrought by cleansing the 10 lepers. But he was focusing what happened after the miracle. That was his interest. Luke was very, very interesting evangelist. So, Jesus is asking, where are the nine? Because you are a foreigner. He was a Samaritan. So, twice he was an outcast. You all know the story of the Samaritans, the outcast in the Jewish history. Now, Jesus is asking, where are the other nine people? So, that is the main question now. What happened to others? Only one man returned and gave thanks to God. But Jesus is not happy. Of course, he is happy with this one man. But he is worried. He is concerned about the other ungrateful people. Dear friends, Thanksgiving festival is an occasion to remind that we have to be grateful to God. If you are not grateful to God, God is concerned about you. Where are the other nine who also cleansed? This is the question raised by Jesus. So, I don't know whether you have examined what happened to these nine people. Why they did not return to Jesus? Why they did not thank Jesus? But I met them. I met all the nine people. And I asked them, why you did not go to Jesus and thank him? I met them. You know what the interesting response I got from these nine people. Let me tell you. First man whom I met, I asked him, why you did not go to Jesus? He said, of course, Jesus cleansed me, but let me wait to see whether it will stay there, or I want to make sure that healing is perfect. Only after that I can go and give thanks. I met the next person. He said, oh, Jesus asked me to go and show to the priest. So I went to the priest and I showed him and I thanked him. So why should I go back to Jesus? Another man said, I am extremely busy. So I have no time to go now. I will go a little later. It's not so urgent. I met the next person. He said, I think I never had a leprosy. Maybe a small skin allergy was there. And it was not really confirmed leprosy. So, it was not a miracle. See, he took it very lightly. When I met the next person, he said, Jesus has nothing to do with the healing. Because healing took place automatically, naturally, normally it took place. So, Jesus has nothing to do with. And the last person, he came with a very interesting remark that Jesus healed me. That's true. So, what is there? He healed me, I am sitting here and I am thanking him. Why should I go and thank him? This is what, perhaps you may ask me, Bishop, when did you meet these people? Where did you meet these people? I tell you, I meet these people among our congregation, among the believers. The same attitude, the same mind of not willing to thank God immediately for the blessing that he has given to us. We take it very slightly, like the lepers. So it is there. What is there? It's not something very important. But when you ask God to bless you, when you ask God to heal you, when you were sick, you were so passionate in your prayer, you were crying. But when God heals you, you are very slow to respond to his goodness. Dear friends, God honors a grateful heart. I also worked as a pastor for more than 30 years. We do have this experience of celebrating Thanksgiving festival. When you plan about the Thanksgiving festival, people will be very happy. They'll all get ready. And the youth fellowship and the women's fellowship and the men's fellowship, they all get into some program. And a lot of things, offertory, brought for auction. There will be a lot of eatables, stalls. So there will be a real celebration in the church. Very interesting. And after the celebration, the priest, the pastor, and the secretary, treasurer, and the responsive people, they sit together. And they used to count the offertory. And immediately they will refer to what is the collection last year? And what is the collection now? These all calculations will be there. Dear friends, I am telling you, let me remind you, Thanksgiving festival is not a fundraising program. It is not a fundraising program. We need money. That is why we are organizing Thanksgiving festival. That is what some people think. That is why they give something and they go away. The church needs money. Okay, let's give something and go away. No, it is not at all a fundraising. But you raise your mind in thanksgiving and come to God with your offertory with humility and gratitude. Dear friends, in the pandemic time, when we really think of God's grace and His protection and His mercy, and we have to give thanks to God. Even during this very, very crucial time when people suffer, even for one meal in a day, people suffer. There are the migrant laborers, those who were walking for many kilometers. Children did not get food because they don't go to the school. If they go to the school, they'll get one meal in a day. They'll be very happy. But this is what happening. We do not know what will happen. But we know one thing, that our God is there and He will always protect us and He will take us on to make us as great witnesses for His holy name. So during this Thanksgiving festival day, take your offertory and keep it in your house. This is my Thanksgiving offertory. When the church organizes it, I don't know when, but whenever the church organizes the Thanksgiving festival, this is what my offertory. I am not offering only money, but I offer myself. But token of my dedication, I give this offertory to God, because God loves a cheerful giver. So maybe this during this Thanksgiving festival season, may God continue to grant us His grace so that we will remain grateful to God for all the blessings that we receive from His holy hand. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
It is not the gift, but the giver is important. Acknowledge God in this Thanksgiving. As God gave His only Son to show His love, Macedonian church people showed love by offering beyond their ability and by giving themselves. And Jesus honors the grateful heart. So let us thank God by celebrating the giver, by giving ourselves to God with a grateful heart, and let us be a witness to the world. With these words in our mind, let us affirm our faith by saying the Apostles' Creed. Let us say the Apostles' Creed together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, the Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, He rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and He will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Love divine, all love excelling. Joy of heaven to earth come down. Church hymnal, hymn number 219. Church hymnal, hymn number 219.
Let us pray. I will sing of the steadfast love of the Lord forever with my mouth. I will make known your faithfulness to all generations. For I said, steadfast love will be built up forever. In the heavens, you will establish your faithfulness. You have said, I have made a covenant with my chosen one. Dearly loving Heavenly Father, thank you for this wonderful time you have given unto us, O Lord. We thank you and worship you once again. Thank you for helping us to feel your presence, O Master. Now we pray for the people, those who are celebrating their birthdays. You have given them grace and you are guiding them with a new year. Help them to feel your presence always. And you are the one who is giving them strength to go into the unknown future, O Lord. They don't need to worry about their future because you are with them. You have chosen them, and you've been a living God who counseled them always, and your protection is available at hand. Thank you, O Master. Enlighten them so that they may let a light in this world, O Lord. Use them as your mighty weapon, an instrument in your hand, O Lord, so that many people may have life through them. You have given your life unto us so that we may taste life, O Lord. We are grateful to you for that very purpose. You have given so much to us. You have providing more than our needs, O Lord. We know that above all, your life which gives deliverance, which saved us, which redeemed us. Thank you for that gift of Jesus Christ, O Lord. Almighty, now we pray for the members, those who are celebrating their wedding anniversaries. Be kind to them, guide them, and use their family as a place of kingdom values to grow and to be shared in the society. Let the love may grow upon in this family every day. Let them taste you through their life, O God. Thank you for the children in their family. You have blessed them. Thank you for being with them and answering their prayers and using them as your instrument, O Lord. Almighty God, we commit all of them in your hands. You be with them, and they may grow in love, in maturity, O Lord, so that they may taste you better and share you better. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Shall we all pray the prayer which the Lord has taught us? Our Father in heaven, holy be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not in temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Shall we all pray the general thanksgiving prayer together? God of all mercies, we, your unworthy servants, give you most humble and hearty thanks for all your goodness and loving kindness to us and to all people. We bless you for our creation, preservation, and all the blessings of this life, but above all for your boundless love in the redemption of the world by our Lord Jesus Christ, for the means of grace and for the hope of glory. And we ask you, give us such an awareness of your mercies that with truly thankful hearts we may show forth your praise, not only with our lips but in our lives, by giving up ourselves to your service and by walking before you in holiness and righteousness all our days, through Jesus Christ our Redeemer, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be all honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. Almighty God, who has given us grace at this time with one accord to make our common supplication to you, and has promised that when two or three are gathered together in your name, you will grant their requests. Fulfill now, O Lord, the desires and petitions of your servants, as may be most expedient for them, granting us in this world knowledge of your truth, and in the world to come, life everlasting. Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all now and forevermore. Amen.
Shall we all sing from the songs of praise the song, Make me a blessing, out of my life may Jesus shine.
Given to you in your need, love as the master loved me.